make a better day, just you and me. You just got it?
Yeah.
Great. Okay, so I'm gonna talk about leaving Neverland. I'm not surprised that a lot of people fell for it, especially with how misunderstood Michael was, especially if most you know about him is from the hugely exaggerated and often completely fabricated media stories. The thing about fans is they actually investigated the documentary and they uncovered quite a lot of bullshit. And when accusers contradict themselves, write contrasting versions of their alleged story, get their sealed, meaning secret, court case dismissed because of that, and then suddenly claim it was never about the money, you do naturally look into it to see if it's not just a case of extortion.
You don't think Michael Jackson has molested one single person?
I do not. I absolutely do not. And I sat with him for 5 months, 5 days a week in a criminal courtroom.
Your facts are fake, your pictures are fake. What else you got?
Let's start with the Safechuck train station story.
At the train station, there's a room upstairs, and we would have sex up there too. What happened every day?
He claims he was sexually abused in the ages 10 to 14, 1988 to 1992. Here's a photo from 93 showing the train station still being built, according to many sources like construction company records, the biographer, and aerial shots. It was finished when James was already around 17. Michael was not even on the same continent the first time he was in Neverland when the train station was already finished, and was back with Lisa Presley. Reed, the director, tried to do damage control on this one, and he said that James must have misremembered.
So now we're at least two years after James Safechuck claims that his abuse, under oath, his abuse by Michael Jackson has ended.
He specifically says it was at the beginning of his abuse, which is at 10, and now there is a big difference between 10 and 17. And I might believe you wouldn't remember when the abuse started, but I'm pretty sure you would remember when it ended.
And James Safechuck is huge! He's much larger than Michael Jackson!
It sounds sick, but it's kind of like when you're first dating somebody, right? You do a lot of it. So it was very much like that.
Another thing about this clip, why on earth would you say it was actually normal, just like at the beginning of any relationship, as if the disgusting part was the having sex with someone often and not the fact that a man is having sex with a little boy? Also, they were still hanging out with Michael when adults, which one, disproves the claim that they were replaced when hit puberty, and two, wouldn't that be awkward for Michael to hang out with grown-ass men whom he abused as a child?
Based upon the narrative they were trying to create, that, you know, Michael Jackson likes you as a prepubescent boy, but as soon as you hit puberty, he's on to some other boy to molest, even though those other boys say nothing happened.
You don't think that for the interviews that they're doing, they're not getting paid? Because yeah. I've been offered six figures already for an interview, and I turned them all down. So you're lucky I got something to lose now, because I would punch you in your face.
Enfants qui sont dans la même situation que Wade et James Effect, ils ont resté très longtemps dans l'entourage proche, à rester à Neverland, et toutes ces personnes ne se sont pas manifestées.
There is no way, an exact way a victim is supposed to act. But let me explain my observations about how controlled these men were in their narratives and how there was no evidence whatsoever. It was just their story. Their bodies were very stiff.
Nobody wants to shame or re-victimize anyone. But you can't forget that the way this film was specifically structured is to elicit empathy in the viewer, and they count on that they will gain your trust by mixing the lies with the truths. This film is also misrepresenting the photos and videotapes, taking them out of context, and it has many contrasting timelines.
They could not survive an onslaught from a factual standpoint, because the story is ridiculous and contradicted in many, 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 many ways.
There are also many moments in the interview with moms. Positive observations about someone or memories get tainted once you discover something like, this man abused my 10-year-old child. I think in hindsight you wouldn't giggle recalling those moments. Wade was also mailing himself articles about previous allegations Michael was vindicated from, and articles about child sexual abuse, almost as if to study the topic of grooming and child abuse. This came out in their declined court case. He also emailed some to his mother.
thank God he can't hurt any more children. Those were my thoughts. And I danced. He can't hurt any more children. I was so happy he died.
Michael died in 2009. This man claims he realized he was abused in therapy long after Michael's death. Why was she so happy dancing the day Michael died? Her supposed friend. I mean, sorry, to me this indicates one of the two. She's either a cold-blooded sociopath or a liar.
I was so happy he died.
Now, before this whole documentary idea came up, Wade already tried to sell the story in form of a book. He wrote various manuscripts, but no publishing company wanted to give him a deal. So he did a couple of interviews, nobody believed him. Here comes James, that looks also to be bankrupt. He joins Wade and they file a lawsuit. Why was the lawsuit declined by the court? Because the stories in the many manuscripts of the book were so contradictory that no sound-minded judge would waste their time with the case, which was clearly an extortion scheme for money from the state. And now here's another problem. Why is Paris, Prince or Blanket to owe anything to anyone? They have nothing to do with it, whether it was true or not. If anything, if you were truly abused, wouldn't you be worried about the kids?
And at no point in the 4 hours does it find even 5 seconds to tell you that these men are suing Michael Jackson's estate for hundreds of millions of dollars. In the documentary, these men, particularly Wade Robson, name other boys who they say were groomed to replace them. And these boys are now men, and they absolutely refute that. One of them is now considering suing the filmmakers.
Okay, the guy's dead. Mm. He can't respond to this.
Wade Robson and James Safechuck are not dead.
No, but the person you're accusing is. And yet, again, I say, other than all the evidence which was for the court cases in which Jackson was finally acquitted, did you unearth any new hard evidence which says that Michael Jackson's a paedophile? Because right now, his whole reputation is being completely trashed by this documentary. I don't know the answer, I'm just asking.
To talk about hard evidence, soiled underwear 20 years later, I'm sorry, that's, in paedophile cases, if this were tried in a court, it would be the evidence of these two very credible witnesses.
But it was tried in court, though.
Well, the Wade Robson and James Safechuck were never.
No, because they were giving evidence in support of Michael Jackson.
The case was to be under seal, meaning confidential, away from the public eye. So here comes another lie. It's not for the money.
I don't believe any of this. I do believe that this is money for the families.
It's all about money.
It's always been about money. I hate to say it, when it's my uncle, it's almost like they see a blank check.
If you think, why would someone completely destroy their friend's legacy for money? You have to remember we're talking about the kind of money that can put your children and your grandchildren and their grandchildren through college, and where you never have to worry about financial trouble again in your life.
He's the biggest target on the planet. He was the most famous person on the planet. He was immensely wealthy. He was perceived as immensely vulnerable. This made him a target throughout his life.
A maid for Michael Jackson received $20,000, more than she annually earned at the time, to lie about seeing Jackson showering at Neverland with a kid. Later on, she admitted in court that this never even happened.
This came out in court, by the way. It's a handwritten note by Wade. Believe it or not, some people would do anything for attention. Attention in any form, even in form of pity. When as little boys they were so close to the limelight, feeling special. It's the kind of thing that is very addictive. And when you're exposed to it, when you're very young and your mind is still forming, it can really mess up your ego for life. And that's why many child stars end up being depressed, abusing drugs, or committing suicide. It's not so far-fetched if you think about it.
And these boys, I mean, what if they were sitting here now, what would you want to say to them?
It would make my flesh crawl, to be honest with you.
And when you think that around 10% of population has some sort of problem with empathy, some sort of empathy disorder, when you're surrounded by thousands of people in your life, you're bound to be target of extortion. It's not like it hasn't happened before. People have a problem believing someone would lie about something like that because we tend to project our own moral compass onto others. And that's exactly the same thing that happened to Michael. Michael projected his own moral compass onto the world and couldn't comprehend him being surrounded by children can be seen as weird or suspicious. Look what we've done. What about all the peace that you pledged your only son? I biggest problem I have with leaving Neverland, though, although it's not in itself a reason to disprove anything, just my personal opinion, I understand you would want to sue your abuser so they don't hurt any more victims, or to make it public so that the other people don't become victims themselves, but Michael is not here anymore, and that alone is a huge red flag that this might be a case of extortion and simply a money grab.
In 2011, Wade got turned down for a job he desperately wanted, this being the lead choreographer of the Michael Jackson 1 tribute show. It was stated he was not good enough. Shortly after, Wade suffered a nervous breakdown due to, in his own words, his career beginning to crumble. It wasn't long after that he started shopping a book about the alleged abuse.
I hate being the person that has to stand up and say, wait a minute, but no one else wants to do this. My dog in this hunt is not Michael Jackson. I don't care about Michael Jackson. I care about the truth, and I really, really care about the rules we're creating for how we evaluate these kind of stories. At 22, in the midst of a massive criminal trial, he is not just a witness for Michael Jackson. He is Michael Jackson's first defense witness. As far as Wade Robson, there is no way in hell that Tom Mesereau or Michael Jackson, if he's a criminal mastermind, is going to put Wade Robson on the stand first in his criminal trial if he's abused him for 7 years, and that Tom Mesereau, who has interviewed him vigorously, his family vigorously, is going to put him on the stand first.
And apparently it's not an easy thing to be drilled by an opposing litigator and to maintain your lie in court, which he claims he did, which means he must be an extraordinary liar. But of course, now he's not lying, and we're supposed to believe him on the premise that each sexual abuse victim processes their abuse differently, and because there's a lot of mysticism around this subject. But is he credible, and is it important?
You have a situation where these accusations are made by two people who have testified differently under oath. The way I judge credibility is, have these people lied before? The answer is yes.
That it was sexual abuse.
Right, he raises his eyebrows when he says sexual abuse. This is called a speech emblem, and it can also be called an emblematic slip as well. Now, he wouldn't be experiencing disbelief if he had been sexually abused.
Michael Jackson changed the world, and more personally, my life forever. He's the reason I dance, the reason I make music, and one of the main reasons I believe in the pure goodness of humankind. I love you, Michael.
Brandy Jackson, Michael's niece, who dated Wade for 7 years, discredits a lot what Wade is saying. But of course, it's a he said, she said. As to the letters and gifts, these were very twisted in Leaving Neverland. They were very misrepresented, very manipulated. The tape was cut up to fit the narrative. He'd send many tapes to all kinds of people, his friends, his adult friends. It seems to me like he would speak and write with a very peculiar vocabulary, and I think it might have also to do with that he was always flooded with admiration from his friends. He had these fans fainting and crying and proclaiming love anywhere he went. When you live your whole life with such a different human interaction, maybe you're just kind of clueless on how you're supposed to reciprocate this love to the world. We tend to be a bit more cautious about expressing ourselves in this way, about expressing love, because of so much rejection we've faced since we were very little. But maybe that is the problem with the society and not Michael.
Und die Wurzeln gesehen habe ich gesehen, er ist nicht der klassische Kinderschänder, der Kinder schändet, um seinen eigenen Lustgewinn zu befriedigen. Er ist also kein Pädophiler, sondern er ist eigentlich Kind, naiv. Er ist wirklich jemand, der sagt, er schläft nicht mit Kindern, er schläft bei Kindern. Und das ist ein Riesenunterschied.
Why can childhood trauma make us feel like a child? We call it developmentally arrested, meaning we're stuck at a certain age because something happened to us.
Been the two of us needed no more. We both found what we were looking for. With the friend to come my own, I'll never be alone. And you, my friend, will see.
To him, hurting a child, he'd rather hurt an adult. If he was going to hurt somebody, he would never hurt a child. This is the last person in the world.
Michael's bed was like a living room sofa. After concerts, everyone, fans, friends, co-workers would jump on his bed, visit, talk, and laugh in Neverland in his hotel suits. I am sure most people do the same thing. I witnessed many times Michael telling the kids to go back to the guest quarters with their parents, and the kids and the parents begging him for the kids to stay in the main house with him. Michael had a difficult time saying no. Michael did most of his work, composing, writing, dancing, at night, so he wanted the time to himself. He would wait for the kids to fall asleep and then slip out to the theater where he was set up to work. If something unethical was happening, a guilty person would limit my access.
You understand, Michael Jackson's bedroom is two stories. And it has like three bathrooms. And the thing is with Michael is that he's not very good at explaining himself, and he never really has been, because he's not a very social person. I mean, you're talking about someone who's been sheltered and sheltering himself also for the last like 30 years.
It was so, oh, kids. But I do truly believe that it's important to keep part of your child with you.
Llama Louie, and they're from the breed of the alpaca as well as the camel.
Michael Jackson. That's the hotel pillow.
Yep. I'm a nice person. I just took a shower and I washed my hair thoroughly.
I feel like James Bond.
Yeah. This is how to do the moonwalk.
Oh, you know how to do the moonwalk. I learned it from you guys.
For those who only heard a couple of songs and saw a moonwalk and heard some wacko jacko, mostly fabricated news back in the 90s and early 20s, there's no way for them to relate to Michael's weirdness, which soon I will explain to you how he was not weird at all. He was an easy target for sensationalist press. I think he was very misunderstood, and that is why he felt so lonely, despite being surrounded by so many people, so many admirers and backstabbers, but that is another story. Loneliness is not about being surrounded by people or not being surrounded by people, being treated well or not. It's about not feeling understood. He was surrounded by so many people, but he probably could never truly relate to any of them or to truly trust them. If you think about it, everyone treated him differently than they would have was he not the Michael Jackson. Even his friends probably treated him special because they were excited to have Michael Jackson as their friend, and most celebrities were actually starstruck by him. As to the love and compassion he had for children, what I think is weird is, why do we find that weird? Are we only capable to feel compassion for our own children? Mother's nature is bonding us to our own so that we feel responsible for them throughout their young years, so that for the survival of our species, we were given a lot more compassion to our own children. But does that mean that the other children are not as lovable, not as cute, not as fragile, not as funny, not as vulnerable, not as deserving of a happy life as our own? Michael saw that. What is strange is that the rest of us sees it as creepy or weird. I really think he was just in a role, more of a role of a mentor, or almost like a big brother or an uncle who happens to have this superstardom and can actually help. He helped Wade in the music business. The faxes he wrote were mostly to Joy, the mother, and they all focused on his future career, what he should be training, which rappers he should try to imitate, and so on. Because imagine a little boy with a dream to be just like Michael Jackson, his room plastered with his posters, he knows every single dance move, he wins this contest, meets Michael, mom's completely starstruck, you can see it even in this documentary. So Michael probably mentions, out of politeness, something along the lines of, let's keep in touch, keep me updated on the boy's progress. The mom thinks his politeness reads much more into it. According to Taj and Brandy Jackson, it's the mother who pursued the relationship. So the whole family became friends with Michael Jackson. He becomes this boy's mentor. He lets him play with his nephews, his niece, other kids at Neverland. Mostly with their parents around, takes him on tours, teaches him to dance. Do you think that Michael would keep saying how there was nothing wrong to sleep in the same room as children if he was actually guilty? I think he simply didn't see through that lens. I don't think he would keep repeating the same sentiment in public. He used his fame for such a beautiful cause, and to twist that, no. I don't think him wanting to spend time with children was for some sort of selfish reasons. They were his inspiration. They were the reason that he would continue with his music. It was him empathizing with the pain of a broken heart of a child. And you can see it clear as day. And just listen to his messages. He communicated with his music. He used his talent for such beautiful cause. He used his fame for such beautiful cause.
I'm gonna make a change for once in my life. That's why I want you to know.
And the whole world abounds in magic. Wonder fills our hearts for what we have glimpsed for an instant, the playfulness of life. And that's why I love children and learn so much from being around them. I realize that many of our world's problems today, from the inner city crime to large-scale wars and terrorism and our overcrowded prisons, are a result of the fact that children have had their childhood stolen from them. The magic, the wonder, the mystery, and the innocence of a child's heart are the seeds of creativity that will heal the world. I really believe that.
He was right about that. The childhood is the key to the world change. It's the childhood that shapes us the most into who we are at our core. Bad childhood either creates very morally bankrupt people or overly empathic, sensitive people. It creates adults with mental disorders and relationship problems, and like he said, it could be the actual true cause of the wars and definitely a cause for ego-driven society.
There are ways to get there. If you care enough for the living, make a little space, make a better place. In the world.
I don't think it was selfish in nature as to recover childhood he lost, as many people think, but rather I think he did connect with children's suffering on a very deep level, and he wanted to bring joy to their lives. I really see this as very genuine, not for show or to cover tracks. It's just too much. Every single city on tour, a hospital, someone who would do this for show or to fulfill the unspoken celebrity obligation for humanitarian work wouldn't go that far as to be putting batteries into toys at night. I mean, come on, he clearly cared about the children, it was his priority. How is having compassion and pure love for the less fortunate an evidence in any way to condemn someone of such an atrocity he's being accused of right now? Neverland is now unsellable. It was built for less privileged children, terminally ill kids, kids from poor neighborhood. His love for children is not strange. It's admirable. It's something we should also find in ourselves. The more you know about his life, the more you see he was not as strange as people thought. His life was strange.
Michael, is it the journalist's role or the press's role to be kind?
I'm not a jackal. I'm Jackson.
The media united in selling the politically correct narrative because no one would want anyone to think that they support child molestation or that they are discrediting victims. Whether it's true or not is irrelevant to them because they could lose a lot of viewership. How these platforms generate articles, a little case study. This guy had a tattoo of Michael, he removed it in 2017 because of his acting career, so this platform decides to spin it for sensationalism, claiming he did it as a response to Leaving Neverland in March 2019. Now someone reads this article, thinks nothing of it, the topic of MJ is brought up in a conversation, and then everyone is so amused at how the diehard fans are now removing their MJ tattoos. And well, it must be true if such fans believe it, right? And it really breaks my heart because all he wanted to do was to lift the world up, to use his talent for good, to help the less privileged, the less fortunate. I'm talking about Michael, I really have no idea what the tattoo guy wants. As to the books they found, there were two books that some people found suspicious, and these were two art books, none of which had Michael's fingerprints on it. One of them had a dedication, handwritten dedication on the front page.
Michael received so many books and magazines from all over the world, and so he had a huge library of all sorts of books. Classical to children's books. I mean, he had a library that was bigger than a public library.
We have the international and interstate capabilities to do investigations that local law enforcement and local DAs don't have. We also have the forensic capabilities.
FBI forensic scientists pored over Jackson's computers looking for evidence of child pornography. Jackson was acquitted.
Hundreds of pages, many, many hours of investigation going to the Philippines, going to Chicago, going all over the country. There's not one scrap of evidence that Michael Jackson ever harmed a child, did anything wrong, committed any crime. It's almost a vindication.
And the media makes these kind of lies spread like viruses and conveniently forgets to follow up with the truth.
Celebrities and public figures influence the masses, sometimes make lots of money, and attempt to do very ambitious things that affect the status quo. Character assassinations and even literal assassinations happen all the time, and for reasons you will never hear about. Everyone has a personal responsibility to at least know what's going on before handing your mind over to the many forms of media indoctrination.
And do me a favor, don't read the tabloids. I love you all very much. And this is our future right here. I love you.
As to his surgeries and the way he looked, I think some people have always been quick to judge him because of how his looks changed over the time. So I'll just be quick on some misconceptions. He did not try to be white, he had vitiligo. He was always proud of his roots. He was using darker foundation and gradually tried to even this out with skin bleaching because he had that condition, not because he wanted to be lighter. He had burns on his scalp, so he wore a wig. He had lupus, which meant he had brittle nails, skin problems, lost his lashes and brows. As to his nose, it's none of anyone's business, whether it was body dysmorphia, his perfectionism, or because of Joe, it really doesn't matter.
Auf der anderen Seite hat immer die Liebe seines Vaters gesucht und derselbe Vater hat sich über sein Gesicht, über seine Akne, über seine Nase mokiert.
And he might have looked strange to you, but for it to be influencing your judgment in any kind of way at all, in terms of these allegations, it's just pure wrong on just so many levels. Image was important back in the day. They'd slap your worst photo at the worst angle on your worst day when you haven't slept or eaten for weeks, for example, because of false allegations being thrown at you, and publish that as a cover with Wacko Jacko or Sicko in the headline and a lie following that. So maybe you'd grow some insecurities too, who knows? People ask, what if these were your children? Well, I can ask you, what if you were Katherine Jackson? What if you lost your son exactly to this kind of media behavior? To watch him be tormented, mocked, ridiculed?
You have to remember one thing. People don't want to know the truth.
How do you rise above that?
I can't say I don't get angry, because yeah. I do.
It's having a catastrophic effect on Jackson's reputation, on his
family, his young kids apparently are having terrible trouble with all this, as you would expect, and so on. So enormous repercussions.
Yeah.
Please, we have to address these things.
Brother, rest in peace.
He left this huge, beautiful legacy, and he deserves it. His mom deserves to feel proud of her son. His children deserve to be proud of their dad. He did so much for the world, spoke to the world through his music and through his actions, and used every single opportunity to inspire the world to make a change. And yet now his legacy is a sick P word on words of two men. No evidence, 10 years of thorough investigation, knowing that there were attempts of extortions in the past. This beautiful place he created to make terminally ill and poor children happy, to create happy memories for them, is now unsellable. They're taking down merch, muting him on the radio, removing his work.
I mean, come on.
They were truly abused. Why couldn't they have just gone to a therapy or a support group? If, as they are saying, they're doing it to help other victims, why on earth is the documentary not focused on ways to cope with past sexual abuse instead of just telling stories for 4 hours, making actual victims feel uncomfortable, having to relive their own abuse, getting triggered? Where's some respect for the FBI or for fact-checking and news reporting?
What a big, big lesson it is on the way we empathize, on the way we form judgments and opinions, and often with very little discernment. How the media dictates to us what it is we should believe. It's easy to empathize with victims of child abuse. It's almost impossible to understand someone whose life was so different to us, how it could make them act differently to us or think differently to us. Obviously, these two are truly the only ones to know, but these two men chose to disclose this story to the public, so they have to be ready to be questioned. The moment this went on HBO instead of a courtroom, I have become a judge by default, so did you, so did thousands of other people exposed to it. I have a problem with the whole argument that you're not supposed to question victims ever, that you're supposed to just trust them at face value, and I understand it's so that the other victims can feel encouraged to come forward, but you can't just completely remove the concept of innocent till proven guilty either. In my opinion, Leaving Neverland does a disservice to the whole Me Too movement, because if you make up lies and those lies are cut out by biographers, family, friends, evidence in form of photos, footage, dated newspapers, phone calls, or simply your own story changing from one draft to another, you will get the backlash and you will be doubted. And then the actual victims will be afraid to come forward because they too might not be believed. I don't really care about these kind of things usually, but with Michael I do care. And yeah, that is all I want to say about this.
I am not guilty of these allegations.
That's your whole story is now discredited.
Make the world more beautiful by sharing with me the wonderful feeling you get when your soul is lifted up to become pure love. I accept this award on behalf of all the children of the world who are my inspiration and my hope. I thank you from the bottom of my heart.
On a des preuves, pareil. Oui, Robson voulait même rester anonyme pour toucher l'argent. Oui.